I'll cut to the chase. So the next chapter is on social sort of attributed causes of fire, and the reason I particularly wanted to talk about this is there's a strong correlation, if you look at it, between population growth and fire. And there's been an argument has been made that really after the end of the influx laws, a huge amount of people came down and settled on the flats, and oh, look at that, the fire goes up. And I think that's complete nonsense. I mean, those people were living out there. And certainly when I came down here, I hardly ever saw an African person on that mountain. I really did not. And so this, what seemed to me to be interesting was what people were doing on the mountain. That seemed to be interesting. So you have the mountain being opened up more and more to and tourism picking up again. And if you look at when fires happen, you start to see clusters around weekends and things. So I really think recreation is what you need to be looking at. And also, it was an excuse, you know, the first half century, it was routinely blamed on Cape colored flower pickers burning for flowers or people collecting wood. It was an easy out. It was much easier to blame those people. Of course, people did light fires, but actually careless picnickers and people's bra flasses falling over once they built that road around Tafelberg Road had a lot more to do with it. So that's an argument I make in that chapter, and I use the census and various other things to try and make that argument. And that takes me to my final chapter, which is my mad attempt to, in one chapter, talk about the actual what happened in fire management and all the big fires through the 20th century. And I try and talk about which the pivotal fires were and the development of the firefighting services. And in some ways it's a bit depressing story because it's a classic story of big fire happens, everyone goes into panic mode, fire breaks are done, everyone's very parat and things are going to change. 5 years later, everyone's forgotten. And to the extent that in newspapers, people are saying, it's the biggest fire since 20 years ago. And actually, 8 years ago, there was a fire just the same dimensions. And the chapter also just does the changes in technology in firefighting. And very late introduction of air. Yeah, actually, P.W. Botha, when he was Minister of Defence, had an inquiry into whether we could use, you know, sort of water bombing, anything with bombing and planes and stuff. It seemed like a great idea. And that guy basically decided, no, it's too windy. And so you had copters in, eventually. There was a guy who came down, David Dates, from the Highveld, and they used copters up there, and he was the guy who brought one in, and it was used in the first year. They had to airlift some German tourists off Lion's Head, and so and we've had it ever since. And that ends with the story of the 2000 fires. And what do I want to say in conclusion? So I'm a historian, so I'm not really offering policy advice on fire management. There are a lot of awfully smart people and dedicated people who've been here, who know a hell of a lot about this. I think there are remaining institutional issues, and part of the interesting thing about this history is just how the kind of political revolutions and social changes and priorities and funding have bedeviled attempts to actually manage fire. And of course, it's an inherently, I'm looking at Pat, it's an inherently cultural thing to manage in a place like this as much as it is an environmental thing to manage. You need fire here, and people don't like it, and they don't want you to burn when their daughter's getting married and get black, and they don't like that falling in their swimming pool, and yeah, who does? But we need fire. Go up there above Kirstenbosch, it should have burned a long time ago. Really, it's mad. When I interviewed my brain's going. Help me, Pat. The man who put together the Cooperative Ecosystem Services, Brian Huntley. He was saying we desperately need a fire here, but we can't burn. The public won't have it. So when it does burn, it's going to be impressive. It's going to be big. And that, would like to see it from a distance. But so that persists. You know, it is surprising that does. What do I want to say? I think that this concept of the natural fire regime can be scrapped. it's quite bold, but people still talk about a natural fire regime, and I do not know what they mean. Because if you atomize what the fire regime is, humans have influenced all the bits of it here, down to spatial. So in the report on the 2000 fires, they say the fire season has not changed. Well, actually, guys, within that, there's a real clustering over the holiday period. There's other smaller clusters around weekends, and climate change. We are changing it. Fynbos is also changing. It's not staying still. So that's my kind of, that's my only real observation I'm going to make rather than a recommendation. And yeah, and that's it. So thank you very much.